We love you. Want you, I'll see you. All of your glory. don't know if you feel it, but the Lord is here. It doesn't take a multitude of people for him to enter a building. He just wants people that are hungry for his presence. I mean, every one of these seats could be filled and he'd not be here. But he has decided to join with us today. Because of your hearts, because of your desire to worship him. So we're going to stay in this atmosphere just for a few moments. And we're going to ask him exactly what this conference is. Is this the more conference? We want more.
And Holy Spirit, you are welcome. Come flood this place and fill the Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for, to be overcome by your presence, Lord.
Let's sing that again.
Holy Spirit, you are welcome.
You made the desire of heart.
Flood this place, fill the atmosphere. Your glory. I want more of you, God. singing, come on. We want more of you, God. We want more. 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 We want more of you. We want more. We want more. We want more. We want more. We want more.
McDonald's, don't eat McDonald's, it's bad for you. But a place will be open for you to eat later. But right now it's time to indulge on God. Right now it's time to fill yourself with God, to go deeper with God, to get more of God. We are coming here today not to go home the same, but to be changed. This is a new year. You hear me? It's a very cliche thing to say new year, new you. But let me tell you, we are going deeper in God today, and it's time for us to get more of God. I want you to open up your hearts today as you hear the word. Each and every one of you. If you were forced to be here, open up your heart. If you came here just because you felt led to be here, open up your heart. If you don't even know why you're here, you thought, okay, more 2016, maybe I'm going to get more Big Mac ribs. Open up your heart. Because I promise you, whatever you need, you can receive today. In Jesus' name. Go ahead and give the Lord a round of applause as loud as you can. In Jesus' name. Oh, you can do better than that. One more time. We praise and worship football team in this score. We praise and worship when the home run is hit. Father, we love you. We praise you. We honor you. We give you the praise. We want you. We want you. We want you. Everybody stand. Amen. 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 It is good to be in the house of Florida. Can I say that?
Yeah.
I mean, we're just like right on the edge of Florida. We're actually staying in a very nice place, or we were. We're going to be going home tonight. It was awesome. Thank you so much for honoring us, Karen. Thank you so much. And look, this is an amazing setup. Can we just give her honor where honor is due? Because she has done everything that she can to make this successful. And let me tell you, this is successful. You know why? Because the presence of God is here.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. All right. 2 nights ago, I woke up, 2 mornings ago, it was 6:45 in the morning. I heard the Lord clearly speak to me. And he said this. He says, the greatest anointing comes from the heart. I'm not going to give you a wishy-washy message. I'm not going to come here to tickle your ears. I'm going to come here and share my story. But also, I'm also going to help you help you. Because I can't just come over here and extend a hand if you don't grab my hand.
All right.
I'm coming here today to give you hope in the most hopeless situations. I'm coming here today to tell you that God is more than you can handle, but he gives you more than you can handle. Are you with me? He also told me that the river is rising. I don't know if it's because of the floods, and I hate that the floods have really affected Georgia and Texas and Alabama. One of my spiritual moms, Karen Wheaton, her whole home, but it was flooded. And that really hurts my heart. And it's funny because they came out with a new album just this, I think, 31st of last year. It's funny to say that because I was like 3 days ago. The name of the album was The River is Rising. It's like, no pun intended, right? But the Lord clearly said the river is rising. And I believe that is a word for you and me today. If you go deeper in God, and if you drink of his spring, He will make you into a great, I'm going to say waterfall. Because a waterfall continues to go and go and go and gives all it can give, but always continues to give more. Are you with me?
Yeah.
Listen, we have more than 12 people here. Guess what? Jesus had 12 disciples that changed the world.
Right.
I am here in Jasper, Florida.
Woo.
No clue where that is. But God is in the midst.
Yes.
See, there was a man, this ain't even in my scripture, and I might even preach on this. But there was a man named John the Baptist. He went to the wilderness to get along with God. That's how I felt when I was driving through this place. But here's the deal. I'm not picking on this place. But I'm saying that God can use the smallest people or the smallest town to make an awakening. Let me give you an example. There's a place called The Ramp. I went there at ministry school. It's a little place in Hamilton, Alabama. Very little. Probably has maybe less than 4,000 people. I don't know. It's very tiny. But they are impacting the world. I mean, one person at a time. They just had a winter in. That's why nobody's here. They had it in Tennessee. Everybody just went up there, and they had an amazing time. But you know what? We are here in this moment, and God is here to tell us that if you want more, the only way that you can get more is if you come after it. The most that you put into it, the most God's going to give into you. And are you with me? And all of you Periscope fans, I love you. I'll see you on Monday. I'm taking tomorrow off. All right. We have to decrease so he can increase. Say this with me. Less of me.
Less of me.
And more of him.
More of him.
Say it one time. Less of me.
Less of me.
And more of him.
More of him.
See, God is looking for people that are not wishy-washy. God is looking for people that are not what we call the lukewarm Christians. Have you ever had lukewarm milk? Okay, have you ever had lukewarm coffee? It doesn't taste really good. Cold coffee is amazing. Hot coffee is awesome. But lukewarm coffee, excuse my language, sucks. Is that okay? Is this a religious church, a religious gathering here? No? It stinks. I'll use that word. That's Christianese. That's a Christian cuss word. Stinks. He doesn't want no lukewarm Christian because if you really see the picture, it says that he will spew you out of his mouth. If I drink lukewarm coffee, I'm probably going to spit it up. If I drink lukewarm milk, I'm probably going to spew it up. What happens with lukewarm milk? More likely it turns moldy, right? It ferments. Do you want to be fermented? Do you want to be moldy when God looks down upon you and he's looking for a man or a woman that he can place a spirit within and give them a mantle and a calling? And then all of a sudden he looks at you and says, man, you got a little bit of green on that bread. You're a little moldy. No, God is looking for somebody that is hot. There is only two things. There is the unsaved and there's the burning. There's no in between. Do you hear me? You might be sitting in the chair like, man, you are radical. Listen, I will tell you I'm radical. I am blessed to be standing on this stage alive this year. You are blessed sitting in your chair alive this year. You don't know what tomorrow brings. You could wake up. You could get in your car. You get hit by a semi-truck. That doesn't sound very appeasing, but it's the truth. There was a guy I just saw where I read an article. He's from Tel Aviv in Israel. He texted his dad yesterday. He said, Dad, I love you and I love life. Well, I don't know if it was today or the day before or whatever. I think today he was killed in a terrorist attack. You don't know when you wake up what is coming at your door. That doesn't mean you be fearful. That means you have God. That means you have the Spirit within you and you have the fear of God, not the fear of people. You know what the best antidote for the fear of people or fear of man is? The fear of God. Take a fear of God pill, and you don't have to worry about what people think about you. See, I don't care what you guys think about me. I love you, but I could care less what you think about me. Because I am here to give you a word today, and I haven't even started.
Amen.
Praise God. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
Hallelujah. You guys are louder than 100 people. I'm telling you right now. This is a good group. Woo! Well, it's a new year, new you. Cliche, right? Man, people try to start a new year and a new you on old habits. You hear me? You try to start a new year. 2015, man, that was really horrible. I went through this. I went through a breakup. My husband treated me really bad, and I wasn't really the best wife. But I'm going to start 2016. I'm going to be the best. But you still have that old habit. You're still dealing with that porn. You're still dealing with being judgmental. You're still dealing with being with a drama queen. Or there's kings here. Stop going into a new year and trying to be a new you with old habits. A new year is where people set goals to achieve. And I'm going to go ahead and read a couple of new year resolutions. And if this is you, raise your hand. Okay, you ready? The top new year's resolution is, one, to lose weight. Me, I would love to be fit like Channing Tatum minus the movie that he just was in, because that is raunchy. Yes. And if you watched it, you need to repent. I would be so amazing, and it would be so awesome if I owned a gym. Because January and February is the awesome time to get a gym membership, and then they are locked in for a year, and you are just banking, and you don't have to worry about nothing. Anybody ever done that before? I've done it. I am here. Okay, number two, get organized. Who wants to get more organized this year? Hallelujah. Stop being messy. That's a sin. Just kidding. They say that being messy is very artistic. Now, with that said, my brother Aaron's very messy, and he is very artistic. He has the camera back there, and I love you so much. Love you, love you, love you. I feel like Elf up here talking to his dad. Number three, spend less and save more. Who wants to do that? Who wants to have, like, let's say, $250,000 in their savings? Jesus! See, we can have that. Why can we have that? Because we have the bank vault of heaven. As long as we put our faith where God lies, as long as we go more into God. It's not the Joel Osteen mess. No, I'm not picking on Joel Osteen. I love Joel Osteen. I think he's great. He's a motivational speaker. He already said he's not a preacher. He's a motivational speaker. But if you give, it will be given back unto you. This is good soil. I would put your money into this soil in Jesus' name. Number five, exercise to eat healthy. Who's that? Exercise to eat healthy. I think that could be all of us. I would love a six pack right now. I'm talking about the abs. Number six, falling in love. Who would want to fall in love? That's going to be me. I mean, I guess I'm the only one. Number seven, quit smoking. Don't raise your hand. Number eight, reading through the Bible. I think that's going to be for all of us. Number nine, growing more in God. See, these are statistics from statisticbrain.com, and everything that you read on the internet is true. I'm just going to go and let you know. And these are the statistics in 2015. 45% of Americans actually made a resolution. But only 8% or so actually accomplished their resolution. I'm going to let you know, if you're going to have a resolution, write it down. God tells us to write the things down that are on our hearts. And if you can write it down, and you can see it, and then you can break it down, and then go into the direction. Yes. See, I heard my brother tell me earlier, if you want to move this building, and you're trying to push and you have all the work and you're trying to move it, you're not going to get to the other side. This building ain't moving. You got to find a door. And when you find the door, you can walk through it. It doesn't matter how much you work. It's how God works with you. Can I get an amen? Amen. All right, funny New Year resolution. Why not, right? Are you guys with me? Are you ready to go home yet? No, I ain't here either. I got a 7-hour drive home after this. Funny New Year's resolution quotes. May all of your troubles last as long as your New Year resolutions. Usually that's about 2 weeks. My New Year resolution list usually starts with the desire to lose between 10 and 3,000 pounds. All right, number three. You guys aren't with me, evidently. 30 ways, and this is going to take you a long time. 30 ways to shape up for the new year. Number one, eat less. Can I get an amen? Number two, exercise more. Can I get an amen? Number three, What was I talking about? I'm so hungry right now. All right. Enough with the jokes. Let's get into actually the Word of God. The truth is that it shouldn't take a new year to become a new you. I'm going to read what I have because I believe this is straight from God. The fact is that there is nothing that you can do to make God love you any more or any less. He loves you because He loves you. Look at your neighbor. Says, God loves you.
God loves you.
And God loves me too. Do you hear me? Jesus Himself, the Creator of the universe, the Righteous One, the One who rent Himself from glory to become a humble servant, who did no wrong, who sinned not, who took the stripes on His back. Listen. Who took the stripes on His back, who died on the cross, who rose again, the One who sits in heavenly places and tells you to come up here. That very God loves you and your brother who was healed of cancer. And if your husband and your sister and your mother, He loves you. He didn't have to rip Himself down from glory. He didn't have to die a brutal death where it said that they couldn't even recognize His face. But He did. And if you were the only person who needed Jesus Christ, He would have came down for you.
Yes.
Are you with me? Yes. Hallelujah. We haven't even got started yet. Can I get amen? This is a quote from Pastor Carl Lentz, pastor of Hillsong Church. I loved it so much. And it said, our God is not a God of behavior modifications. He's a God of soul transformations. That's a truth bomb. We're going back to Periscope. Truth bomb, going back to it. You ready? God is not a God of behavior modifications, but He is a God of soul transformations. I want to talk to you today about a rebirth, a renewal, a revival. I'm going to hit three quickly things because I've already been talking for a very long time. But you know what? I got a 7-hour drive, so I might as well talk for another 3 hours. Are you with me? Amen? No? The chairs are very hard? That's fine. Trust me, I can't even talk that long. Actually, I can. All right. I want to talk to you about more. More of what? Number one, more healing in your life. That doesn't have to be just a physical sickness, but it is a physical sickness. It could be a mental, it could be a physical, it could be a spiritual, it could be financial, relational, whatever it may be, I want you to have a healing today. Amen. If you would like a healing today, say amen.
Amen.
The second thing I want to talk to you is about more faith. Mountain moving faith. Have you ever seen somebody with mountain moving faith? I look in the mirror every single day of somebody with mountain moving faith. That's not me being very cocky. That's me being very, very, very understanding who I am in God. Because when you look in the mirror and you say, oh, you're really nobody special, you're telling God you're nobody special. Because you are created with the own hands of God, out of the mud, out of the clay, your mom, your dad, whatever. We ain't going to go there. But you have been created in the image of God. That's number two. And lastly, we're going to talk about more resurrection power, which brings revival. Amen. If you're with me, say amen.
Amen.
More healing. I'm going to talk to you really quick about wounds versus scars within this healing process. If you've ever had a wound before, raise your hand. All right. If you ever had a hurt heart wound or a physical wound, or a relational wound, raise your hand. I know it's very uncomfortable. This might not be a hand-raising church. We aren't carrying the baby right now, okay? We're not washing the windows. We're not field goaling. Small TV, big TV, Mufasa. We're not doing that right now. I'm asking you a question. It's okay to answer. Wounds versus scars. Everybody has gone through a wound. And it's either self-inflicted or inflicted by somebody else. But usually it's self-inflicted. You are a part of it. It's either a relational or a physical or whatever. I've gone through wounds, and I'm about to tell you about a story that I have gone through. But when you have a wound, if you push on that wound, what happens? It hurts. Welcome in the back. God bless you guys. We have two more. Thank you, Jesus! Periscope people, you might not know what's going on. I'll talk to you later. So there are wounds that you have to get healed. And the only way you can get healed is going towards who? Jesus. If you have a wound, if you've got your arm cut, what do? You either go home, put Neosporin on it or ointment, or you go to the doctor because it's too deep and they clean it up. Well, I want to talk to you really quick about Adam and Eve. Before you can get a healing of a wound, you have to realize where the problem came. Before you can have a solution, you have to know where the problem came. Adam and Eve, very quickly, I think you all know it unless you haven't been to church, and that's fine. But Adam and Eve failed. They ate from the tree of good and evil, the knowledge of good and evil. At that very moment, they saw that they were naked. They were shameful. They hid from God. God came and said, "Where are you?" Why did God say, "Where are you?" He knows everything. Well, I believe that in Scripture it says that God himself cannot, he couldn't look upon sin. I've never heard this before, but I got this the other day. God cannot look upon sin. He said he had to turn his back on his own son because he had sin placed on him on the cross. Even though God could look past the sin, look past the veil, I believe that when sin covers us, God says, "Where are you? Come back home." It's not that you are hiding from him and you're trying to, but it's because the shame and the guilt is on you so much and you feel naked, you feel shameful, you feel guilty, and you hide from God. And what happened? God redeemed them, but he put them out of the garden east. We then get Cain and Abel on. Cain kills Abel. Cain is casted east. You got the Tower of Babel. Tower of Babel. Oh, that is this west or east? I don't know. It doesn't matter. I'm going this way. So what's going on is Tower of Babel. They ended up putting them further east. Why? East was a place of disobedience. If you look in Scripture, if you look at the very first time a word is said, then that's usually what goes along for a certain amount of time. And as you see, the word east means you're going away from Eden, which was the perfect, peaceful place. There was nothing they ever needed. They were satisfied, but they kept on going east because of disobedience until a man named Abram came on. Abram and Lot. Lot was told, he said, "I want to go east." You know which way Abram went? West. He went towards Eden. He went closer to the place where God directed him to do. And I'm coming here to tell you today, stop going east in disobedience. We have to allow God. The only way that we're going to get our wounds healed is if we start to go towards the feet of Jesus. And understand when we sit in his presence, when we worship in his presence, that he starts to heal us little by little in Jesus' name. The temple itself, the temple when it was first built, and even in Revelation, it says that you enter the temple through the east gate. Why do you enter through the east gate? Because you're walking west. You're walking towards what God has told you to do. Stop walking towards disobedience and walk towards obedience. So why is this part of healing? Well, when you have wounds, you hide. But when a wound turns into a scar, man, you got a pretty cool story to tell. Anybody ever had a scar on you, like you tell somebody, "Hey, this is what happened." Man, there's a scar right here, man. What happened is there's a chainsaw. We were cutting a tree, and all of a sudden just it went halfway into my leg, went into whatever this muscle is, Aaron knows, into the bone. And then this is a shoe scar, but then it got healed, and then now I'm like, I got a really cool story to tell you. Chicks love scars. That didn't happen to me, but that would be pretty cool if you lived to tell the story. When you have a scar and you've been healed by the wound, either physically, spiritually, relationally, either a broken heart, either you went through cancer, either whatever it is that you went through, if you go to Jesus and you get healing and you receive a scar, then you can tell people about the goodness of God. A scar is visible. A scar doesn't hurt when you pick at pride anymore. It's healed. Jesus himself, 2,000 years ago, 33 A.D., you know what he did? He took 39 lashes on his back. They were wounds at that time. And they soon healed. And guess what? He has scar prints on his hands because he has a story to tell. Yeah. I can't wait when I meet him face to face. Yes. And he says, look at these hands. This is what I did for you. Look at these feet. This is what I did for you. Look at this back. That was for your healing. That wasn't, look at the crown of thorns, the imprint that was in my skull. That was for your mental stability. My blood covered you. He has a pretty cool story to tell.
Yeah.
I got one cool, but it's not as cool as his. It was October 2012. It's late at night. And I might fall off the stage, but it was late at night. And I heard a voice. And I don't think many of my family members know this. I heard a voice and it said that I'm going to kill you. And I said, okay. I knew the scriptures. And that night, I woke up in the middle of the night with a lump in my neck. I couldn't breathe. And I found a lump in my neck about the size of a fist. Went to the doctor about 2 to 4 weeks through testings. The doctor comes back and says, Jared, you have stage 2 cancer. Then a little bit later, he says, no, I'm sorry, it's stage 4 cancer. And I'm like, okay. I said, I don't believe your report, doctor, but I believe the report of the Lord, because the word of God trumps your word every single day. Yeah. It doesn't mean I'm crazy. It just means that I believe.
Yes.
The word of God trumps your word, your word, your word. And I can actually go keep on going without making a lot of time leave. It trumps any word any man can have. It doesn't mean that it was truth in the world that we live in today that I had stage 4 cancer. But I had to make a declaration at the very beginning that you are not going to give me a death report. You are not my creator and you are not my maker. You are not going to take me home and you aren't going to be anywhere near me. In Jesus' name. So he told me that. He said, we need to go ahead and go through chemo. You're going to lose your hair within the first, 2 weeks. I said, okay, that ain't going to happen. I love my hair. As you see now, it's gone. But I have a testimony. So what happened was, is that I came back home. I was living in Tennessee away from family doing ministry. Came back home because when you go through something, you want to be with people that believe in you. I'm telling you right now, that was 2012. I believe that I would not be standing here right now if it wasn't for my family and with my faith and the people that have prayed for me and believed with me. And you think this testimony is awesome because I'm standing here right now. Just wait. There's more. So what happened is I came back home. I was doing the craziest amount of chemo. 2 months go by. My hair's still intact. Thank God. And you know what? The doctor said, I didn't throw up one time. They said you're going to be sick all the time. Didn't throw up or anything. Then all of a sudden, they do a testing. And they said, Jerry, I don't understand it, but the cancer's gone. I said, because I believe in the word of God, and I have hope, and I want to give hope to the hopeless. If you're hopeless today, I want to give hope to the hopeless, because there's more of God, more of God, more of God. I wish that story would have stopped right there, but God wanted to make my testimony just a little bit better. They're laughing because they know the story. So about a year later, maybe 8 months, I started getting some back pain. I was like, oh man, I might have tweaked it working out. You knew I wasn't working out. I'm sorry for you guys in the back. Just laugh with us. So I didn't tweak my back. I got testings done and they said, Jared, I'm sorry you got stage 4 cancer again, but this time it's in the bone. And I was like, oh man, this stinks, man. God, what's going on? What have I done wrong? Have I sinned? I'm looking at the Bible. No. God doesn't give us sickness. That is not his character. Do you understand that God's character is healing? It is blessing? He wouldn't create something to destroy it. Scripture itself says that let his kingdom come, let his will be done on where? As it is in? Is there sickness in heaven?
No.
Is there debt in heaven? No. There's debt here because we're stupid sometimes.
Amen.
So, spend less, say more, get out of debt. That was my Dave Ramsey talk for you today. So there's no sickness in heaven. So why does Jared Rooks have cancer? I had to say, you know what? I told the doctor again, I don't believe your reports. I believe the report of the Lord because I know what Scripture says about faith. It says faith is a substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. And I don't see a healing, but I'm hoping for it. And when you don't see it, but you believe it, it will manifest in Jesus' name. Yes. I'm just crazy enough to believe it. You know I'm crazy enough to believe it? Because it's in the Word. Amen. You've got to read the Word. I don't want to go up to heaven and stand in front of God and say, who are you? I don't read about you in there. That's because you're reading Harry Potter. You know what I'm saying? So, I literally, so I was like, okay, I believe in the Lord. I believe in this healing. I said, you do your doctor stuff, your science stuff, whatever. I believe that God can use it because God created you. He created your mind, and He can create whatever He wants to create to use it. But I'm going to use my faith as well. And we're going to meet in the middle, and we're going to see a miracle in Jesus' name. Can you say amen?
Amen.
All right, all right. So we went through chemo. We went through heavy chemo. I'm telling you, not many people can survive it. I'm not boasting in me. I'm boasting in the Lord.
Yes.
I went through a bone marrow transplant. These two people and the one in the back, they're my peoples. They can attest what I went through. I lost 20 pounds in 7 days, and I felt like I was on my deathbed. I was in so much pain and so much agony that, you know what? You would want to think that you want to turn away from the Lord and just die. You wanted to be like Job and say, you know what, God? No. I am done with this life because you have given me a bad lot. Have you ever felt that way? If I'm boring you, you can go ahead and go. Are you feeling that? Have you ever felt that way?
Yes.
It's like, God, why did my whatever have died? Why do I have to have cancer? Why did I have to... I went through a breakup. I was engaged a month before my wedding. God, why did that happen? It broke my heart so much. Why? Because God says, I'm protecting you in that situation. So I just said, God, you know what? I trust you. I trust you. I trust you. I lost those 20 pounds, but within 6 months, I was back to a healthy weight. Everything was going good. All of a sudden, I find a lump in my neck. Third time. They look at it and say, sorry, Jared, you have cancer again for the third time. We're going to need to go through 25 rounds of radiation. And I was like, goodness gracious, what else can I do? I mean, can I really endure any more pain? Can I endure any more radiation? Can I endure any more chemo? And I say, God, I believe your scripture. I have hope in you. And I say, God, I trust you. I have faith. I don't believe you're for it. Do you, boo-boo? If you don't know what that means, check my periscope out. I don't know what it was this. But you know what? I went through 25 rounds of radiation, was done with it. My neck was scarred, or it was burnt. Remember me was being burnt? And I started doing healthy living. I started eating healthy. Now I'm feeling really good, juicing. Anybody ever juiced before? It sucks. But you know what? I was doing it. And I was like, God, yes, it's good. Back to healthy levels. Everything was looking good. My blood's looking good. And then 6 months later, all of a sudden, the doctor says, Jared, I'm sorry, but you have stage 4 cancer this time. And it's the worst it's ever been. I'm like, God. I'm scratching my head, but he's up there. He's not scratching his. I'm down here, I'm down with him, and he's not down with me. I'm down here, I'm like, God, just take it away from me. He's like, son, I have it under control. I'm building you a testimony because I know I can trust you. I could care less if there's a million people in here. I preached the empty rooms before because I preached it only to one, and that's Jesus Christ. So it came back. And it came back with vengeance. And I said, you know what? God, I don't believe the report. I believe the report of the Lord. I'm going to have faith that you do your mental and your whatever you do. It's not even mental, but whatever it is. Do it. And I'm going to have faith. We're going to meet in the middle. We're going to see a miracle. I went through more chemo. How much can your body handle chemo? I'm a walking testimony. went through chemo, went through more radiation. And then they said, we want to do another bone marrow transplant, but here's the deal. You got a 50-50% chance. Woo, that's a great odd. Panthers have a better odds of winning the Super Bowl. And they're going to win in Jesus' name from Charlotte, North Carolina. He said, you got a 50-50 chance. We're going to give you a bone marrow transplant. We're going to use your brother Brad or Aaron. They ended up choosing Brad. They put both of their pictures on a wall. They threw a dart and hit Aaron. They said, you're dead to me. Brad is going to be the transplant donor. That's not what they did. That would have been a pretty cool story. So we did the transplant. They said, Jared, you got a 30% chance of it not working. 50% chance of... Well, it's just weird. They're saying you don't have a good chance. But I said, you do your doctor thing. I'm going to do my faith thing. We're going to meet him and we're going to see a miracle. Because I believe the word of God. And even if I would die on my deathbed in the hospital with cancer, I still believe the word of God. We went through chemo. We went through radiation. They said this time it wouldn't be as hard. Listen. I went through the transplant. Everything went well. I've been put back into the hospital 5 different times with a bladder infection. You ever had a bladder infection? That hurts. I've had 48 kidney stones. That's another testimony. Don't know why. We had to go through chemo. We had to go through radiation. I had to get back put in the hospital because of fevers. I'm on all these medications, and it's like, oh, you have so much faith on your medication, because it's called common sense. It's called wisdom. Just because you're going through something, there are people all the time that say, you know what, I'm going through cancer, but I'm just going to trust God, and they die trusting God, and that's fine. That's awesome. If that's faith, then it's not sin. But there's times where you ask for wisdom, and God says, you know what, I'm going to protect you in the midst of the most hardest drugs that anybody can ever give you. Chemo kills the body. Look at me today. Do I look like I've had chemo? Do I look like I've had cancer besides the beautiful bald head? You can laugh. It's not true. It's more 2016 conference. Hashtag. Tweet that. Guys, I'm here to tell you today that I went through the transplant. I went through stage 4 cancer 4 different times. If it wasn't for God, I would have been dead the first time. If I wouldn't have my trust in the Lord, you know what? I would have withered up and died like most people that get a death sentence with stage 4 cancer. They said at the very beginning, I said, don't give me a prognosis because I don't receive it. Are you with me? So you might have a wound, you might have a scar. If you have a wound, get closer to Jesus. Sit at his feet, bask in his glory, and he will come through in his timing. Yeah. Sometimes I'm looking at me like, God, your timing is way off. You know what God's timing is? This is me praying. You ready? 1 week, God, I love you. 2 week, God, I can't believe you're doing this to me. 3 week, God, I'm so in love with you. Yeah, rock star for Jesus. 4th week, man, I can't stand you. You know what he hears in a couple of seconds? God, I love you. I can't stand you. I love you. You're a rock star, man. You suck. I would never tell God that. Let me tell you, God's timing is perfect. You have to wait on it. But if you have a wound today, I'm going to tell you, it's time for you to get a scar. It's time for you to have a story. Because your testimony is supposed to defeat the enemy. That's what Scripture says. Revelation 12. We defeat the enemy by the word of the Lamb. By the word of our testimony and the blood of the Lamb. If you're with me, say yes.
Yes.
I'm going to speak to you these last two. Are you asleep yet?
No.
Better not. I got some water in the back. We're going to have a baptismal. We're baptizing people in Jesus' name. So what is faith? Faith is the substance of things hoped for. Okay? I want to give you a quick picture of what faith is. We just got done with Christmas. Has anybody had faith in here? Raise your hand. This is what true faith is. You're a little boy, little girl. Well, you run downstairs. It's Christmas time. You sit. I'm not going to sit because I can't get back up. But you sit in front of the Christmas tree and you see a present. It's red. It's beautiful. It has a bow. It has your name written all over it. You know it's yours, and you're just anticipating to open that present, and it's yours. This is what faith is. See, your parents aren't going to come in and take the presents away and throw it away. You have to wait for it. You have to be patient for it. And then when it's time to open the present, automatically, you see the gift that God's given you. And if you wait patiently enough and your faith endures and you do not give up hope, then it is yours. Jesus himself, he was walking down the street. There was a woman with the issue of blood. 12 years. All of a sudden, she hears commotions. What does she hear? She hears about Jesus coming. Well, what does Jesus do? Well, Jesus has cured the blind, has healed leprosy, has raised the dead. Man, everywhere this man goes, Jesus, in Spanish is Jesus, Jesus himself, he's coming. Everywhere he goes, there is a miracle. Are you with me? So when you see Jesus, you are anticipating a miracle. So you have this woman with the issue of blood for 12 years. She's gone to every physician and grew worse. If you go to a physician and you get worse, I would choose another physician. Jesus is the greatest physician. Because all of a sudden it says that she sees Jesus, she's bleeding. It says in her time in Jewish custom, she has to say, I'm unclean. But what does she do? It says in the scripture, it says within herself, she says, if I would just touch the hem of his garment, I'd be made well. That, my brothers and sisters, is faith. Come on in. Sit down. It's okay. God bless you. Don't mean to interrupt, but it's okay. Come on in. Come on in. That's what faith is. Faith that the Son of Saints hoped for. She was hoping for a healing for 12 years, and all of a sudden, Jesus himself walks into the room, and what happens? She says within herself, why does that matter? Because the Word of God, you have to know it to be healed. You have to know it to receive your miracle. You have to know it to know it. If you know God's Word, then God's Word works when you work God's Word. But it says in Scripture It's Romans chapter 10. It says, faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. See? That's what God does. He comes, remembers. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. What did she hear? She heard that a man who knew no sin, who knew no woman, who sinned not, who has healed anybody who's ever come in contact with, he's coming. Guess what? She put all of her faith, all of her hope in that man. She came through, weaved in, touched the garment, and immediately she felt within herself that she was healed. Jesus, he said, who touched me? Are you serious? Then this is, I love to read the Bible and put myself in the perspective of other people. Here goes his apostles. Are you kidding me? You've got 10,000 people standing beside you, buffing you, trying to be bros. He said, who touched me? You know what happened? People were touching him flippantly. They were touching him with no purpose. My question to you today is this. Do you want more of God? Do you want to touch Jesus with a purpose? What are you going through that you need God to touch? Because if you say it within yourself and you believe within yourself, if you would just touch the hinge of his garments, that you would be made whole. Then I'm telling you, your faith would made you well. Many times in the Bible, Jesus says this very sentence. Your faith has made you well. It's exactly what he told the woman with the issue of blood. Guess what? She's no longer the woman with the issue of blood. I did the story injustice. I gave it away. It should be the woman that had blood that was for 12 years that got healed by Jesus. But that doesn't make a good story because you can't tell the story if it has an ending. What is your ending? What is your end goal? Your end goal is to get more of God. To have more healing in your wounds. To become a scar. To tell a testimony. And not only that, to have a story to tell with your faith that moves mountain. That I can stand here today and tell you that I am healed of stage 4 cancer for the 4th time and last time in Jesus' name.
Hallelujah.
I thank you, Jesus.
Yes.
You can clap. It's okay. I'm alive. I'm standing before you today. And last but not least, more resurrection power, revival. Is that, I mean, if we think about it, we want this place filled up. But sometimes we have to go out to get them in. Sometimes we have to go to the streets and just love on somebody for them to realize that Christians aren't really just judgmental. That Christians aren't just really just bigots, bashful, and hate every single person. Listen, I will ask you to invite people to your church service. I would ask you just to live a life that is so full of God that you leak. Just like a champagne bottle. Thank you, Aaron. Give you credits. Champagne bottle. Anybody cork a champagne bottle this year? Please tell me that. You did? It's okay. I won't judge you. I'll meet you here at the end. But think about that. Think about what's inside the cork bottle. It's carbonation, right? You, with the Holy Spirit within you, I'll call him the Holy Ghost just to offend some religious people. You with the Holy Spirit with inside of you is like carbonation. And if it just was like a Coke or the champagne, you shake it up. And then what happens? There's only one way to go. And that's up and out. Let me tell you something right now. You might have been down in 2015. You might have been thrown down by the enemy in every single way. I know I have. There was times where I felt depression. There was times where I felt loneliness. There was times where I didn't know if I could do it anymore. And the enemy threw me down so much, but guess what? There's called a rebound. And in 2016, we're going to shoot right back up like a champagne bottle. And we're going to cheer. And we're going to see more of God. And we're going to see revival in this city once again. In Jesus' name. I believe it. I believe it because the Word of God speaks of it. Has He came the second time yet? The Scripture say that He will pour out His Spirit onto all flesh. Yes. Have we seen that yet? We've seen it in droves. We've seen it in little parts here and there. But Jesus is looking for a people. Maybe it's even 15 people sitting in here that will say, you know what? I want to usher in the second coming of Jesus Christ. If you want to be one of those people, just say amen in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Hallelujah. More resurrection power. I'm going to talk to you really quick, and we're going to end here in just a little bit. Brad, give me about 5 minutes and get back up here, okay? Man, I'm bossy. Lazarus. Remember the story of Lazarus? If you're a Christian, you're not a Christian. Lazarus. He was Jesus' friend. He was such a close friend to Jesus that he actually ate with them. He lived with them. He dined with them. He walked life with them. Lazarus had two sisters, Mary and Martha. Mary sat at the feet of Jesus. Martha was a busy doer. Who's a busy doer? And it's okay if you are. There's different ministry types. But Martha sat at the feet, or Mary sat at the feet of Jesus. And they told Jesus, and this is the original, well, this is today, modern day, right? They text Jesus. They said, Jesus. You text with your thumbs or your fingers? What happened to that? My phone's too big. I think I'd do that. So they said, Jesus, the one whom you love is sick. Jesus didn't come immediately. Well, a couple verses before, Jesus came and just had a meal with them. He answered that text message real quick. It said red. And he came straight up. But this time, it said red. And he said, I'll be there. Be there when it be. And he doesn't show up. Now we have Lazarus in the tomb. He's dead 4 days. Why is he dead for 4 days? Why did Jesus wait 4 days? Well, let me tell you the scripture right here. In John 11:11, Jesus tells his disciples, our friend Lazarus has fallen asleep, but I go to awake him. I'm telling you today that some of us in this room, and I know it's very small, but some in this room have fallen asleep spiritually. And Jesus is saying, I'm coming to wake you up. Why was it 4 days? Well, they believed that the Spirit itself stayed around the body for 3 days. And when the fourth day came, the Spirit was gone. So there was no chance of resurrection. Also around day 4, the body starts to decay. It starts to stink. Look at your neighbor and say, stink. Stank. The body started to stink. And then all of a sudden, Jesus comes, Lazarus is dead, he's already in the tomb, he's wrapped up, he's smelling so bad that flies are probably on top of him. And then all of a sudden, he comes and Martha greets him and says, if you were here, he wouldn't have died. You have been healing every single person that you have touched, and all of a sudden, your best friend's here and you haven't came to heal him? Have you ever felt like that? It's like, God, you did a miracle for them, but you didn't do a miracle for me. You touch them and they're like, they're blessed. They don't even follow you. But I'm not followed. But I'm not blessed. And Jesus, she's calm. Where's Mary? Man, she's in her room. She don't even want to talk to Jesus. She got an attitude. And all of a sudden, this is what Scripture says. Jesus said, actually Martha said this. She said, even now, I know that you can do this, so to speak. And Jesus said, well, in the resurrection, she says, I understand in the resurrection that he'll be raised. She was thinking about the future. But Jesus himself sitting and standing in the flesh was saying, no, you don't understand. I waited because I wanted to turn that wound into a scar. I wanted to give you faith so that you can go through your next battle. When you go through a trial, understand the last testimony that you just went through will be the ammunition for your next trial. And then when you get through that trial, the next trial, that testimony will destroy that trial and your faith will not waver. But this is what Jesus said. No, this is not a future thing. John 11:25. Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection. I can say that because I'm alive. I don't have cancer anymore. Yes. He is the resurrection. Man, I care less. I have cried more stages than you guys probably even know. He says, I am the resurrection and the life. Whoever believes in me, though he die, yet shall he live again. And everyone who lives and believes in me shall never die. Do you believe this? And all of a sudden, Jesus tells him to roll away the stone or whatever he told him. He goes in there. And I can you just feel the anticipation in the room? Everybody's looking at us, whoa! Hold on, first and foremost, you're a Nazarite. First and foremost, you're a priest. You can't touch a dead thing. It's against your religion. And all of a sudden, he goes in there. He says, Lazarus, come forth. Dead man walking. Have you ever seen a dead man walking? That's close. Can you imagine the people that God, Jesus himself told him to go get them, take them out? This man mummified, rolling out, and you got these people unwrapping him. And everybody's looking, they're gazing on him because a true miracle, a scarring has came, a healing has came. Faith has started being brewed in the room. And Lazarus come out and he stinks. But what happens is everybody sees a miracle, and everybody believes that he is the one who is to come. Yes. That he was in the flesh. That 2,000 years ago, he took cancer and he put it on the cross. 2,000 years ago, he put a wounded heart on the cross. 2,000 years ago, he put a wounded mind, mental stability, instability. He put whatever you're going through on the cross. And this is what happened. Jesus died. When he went to the grave, cancer went into the grave. I'll clap myself. It's okay. I'm good. I don't need your applause. I got his. When he went to the grave, depression went to the grave. Went to the grave, your stress, your anxiety, your broken heart, your relational issues, your debt, it went to the grave. But when Jesus Christ came out of the grave, it stayed in the grave. It's no longer yours to take, my friend. You can't own something that somebody already took ownership of. So I'm here to tell you today, God is here to heal you. God is here to build your faith. And God Himself is here to resurrect your spiritual life, to bring revival, and to show the world that He is true, that He exists, and that He is coming again. If you're with me, say amen. Amen. Close your eyes with me. Matter of fact, stand up. I'm going to give you a break. It is time for you to tap into the heavens. It is time to receive more healing. It is time to obtain more faith to move mountains. It is time to step into your destiny and become a revivalist. Revival is when you stand in a circle and you wait until God comes. And then when revival comes, you take it to the nations. Revival is when a man stands in the pulpit and he forgets what he is even talking about. And he steps outside the pulpit and lets Jesus stand in it. And let Him dictate the servants. That's revival. When you walk into the room, everything changes because He Himself is in you. Christ, the hope of glory, has placed power inside of you. Power to defeat your enemies. And if you don't think you have enemies, let me tell you, you do. They are here on this earth. They are assigned to your life to destroy you. They are assigned to your life to make you fall and stumble. But He's given us the Word of God. He's given us the faith and the power of God to withstand the enemy. You might be in a battle for your life. You might feel like you're going through 12 rounds, but guess what? Jesus is standing in your corner and says, if you just tag me in, you can sit on and you can look at me and knock out the devil. It is time for us to make a call. It is time for us to answer His call. First and foremost, and I'm not going to embarrass you, but I want you to know Jesus. You might say, well, I was baptized when I was little. I received Him when I was little. And I didn't have a sin all year. I haven't sinned for 2 days. Listen, if you feel like you have been far from God, it's just going to be a simple hand raise. I'm not going to call you up front. We're going to pray. But then we're going to have some ministry time. Listen, I know some of you guys are here. Some of you have been here for a long time. And I thank you so much for being patient. But this is one of my most favorite times. And so I can pray and we can pray and see God work miracles. I believe there's people in here that need a touch from God, like the woman with the issue of blood. And I believe today is your day. You might have diabetes. And actually, that's a word of knowledge. Somebody in here has diabetes. And God wants to heal you today. And then I'll have you come down a little bit. But if you feel like you're far from God, and you don't know if you would go out tomorrow and get hit or died or struck by lightning or drowned or whatever, and you don't know if God would accept you into the kingdom of heaven, and you're having this kind of wishy-washy, you just don't even know, and you want to make sure 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 that you are with Him, I want you to raise your hand right now in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. God, we thank you right now. We thank you. We thank you, Father God. We receive you. And you don't even have to say a prayer. You have to believe it with your heart that He is who He says He is. And He has written your name in the Lamb's Book of Life. Really quickly, I'm going to let you go here a little bit. If you have to go already, that's fine. Go home. I promise you, McDonald's will be open. But I am here for a reason. I've driven down seven. Well, I didn't drive. Thank you, guys. 7.5 hours. So I can love on you guys just for a little bit. At least give me another 10 minutes. If you've had a wound, and it's still a wound, and I know we have a lot of wounds. I know there's somebody in here, and I know I've had a wound. But if you have a wound, that you're like, God, I just need this to scar over. I need your ointment. I need your anointing. I need you to heal me. And you want to come to the feet of Jesus. If you have a wound that you say, God, I just can't do this by myself. I need you to heal it. Just raise your hand. Yep. Yep. Got a couple hands. Amen. Yes. Thank you, Lord. It's all right. Even if you don't raise your hand, God knows if you have a wound. You can't hide it. Well, I want to pray for you today. And I believe the power of prayer will save the sick. I believe the power of prayer will bring revival. Everybody with me, just do me a quick favor. I'm not going to ask you to raise your hands, but can you just put them like right in front of you? Like you're catching a gift. Just open your hands. Don't be greedy. See, what happens is, if you have your hands closed, you can't get anything. Open your hands. Now I'm going to pray. I'm going to ask God to come down and to fill you and to heal you and to bring the healing of your wound, to turn it into a scar that turns into a testimony. Father, we come to you humbly and boldly before your throne. We rip through the veil that was already torn, and we say, God, we know you're at the right hand of Jesus. You're at the right hand of God. And we come to you and we say, God, we need you. We need more of you, God. Every single person, raise their hand and say, God, I have a scar or I have a wound. Right now in Jesus' name, I speak healing to the mind of the mental abuse right now. That's a word of knowledge. Mental abuse has been healed in Jesus' name. Father, the wounds are being closed up by your anointing in Jesus' name.